I'm here with David Gahan.
You are.
Depeche Mode. I'll start with the album, Spirit, 14th studio record. Mm-hmm. 37 years as a band, that hurts to say a little bit.
Not as much for, as it does for me. But I'm really proud of the work that we've done together and all the places and things and that we've done together and been through. And, you know, it's like a weird marriage when you're in a band. You know, there's sometimes when you hate each other's guts and you can't be in the same room together, and other times when you're on stage when it all makes sense and it's like, oh, this is why we do this.
The album overall, musically, has a very hard edge to it, and obviously the content of the songs. Yeah. Was that conscious while you were making it?
First of all, it struck me that it was a really solid album from start to finish. It had a great feel to it. It really felt like it had two sides, like an old piece of vinyl.
Sure.
It can make or break a record, I think. Yeah. You know, the way you sequence the songs together, you know, it's a heavy listen. It didn't feel like that when we were making it, but when you listen to it in its entirety, it's like we're really kind of upset about what's going on in the world.
Yeah.
Can't help but be influenced. You know, when you're making any kind of art, it's like I hope that you are influenced by what's going on around you, and then hopefully someone who's in our case listening to our music, they're moved to feel something, to act on something, to do something, to maybe check themselves. What do I really feel about that? You know, how do I really feel about this person that lives next door to me that's, you know, from Somalia, you know, or whatever. It's like, who am I really? You know, I think that's really what it makes me do.
I think the thing, and you bring a unique perspective to this being from England, is that it doesn't feel isolated to America, right? It feels global, that this change is happening. Mm-hmm. And to me, a lot of your early records felt, you know, they're very thematic.
Yeah.
And you take something like People Are People, that became almost like a mantra for like a generation of kids, right? So this album doesn't seem so out of place in that context.
It's really not. And I think we've always touched on things, and I think our albums over the years have had themes kind of running through them, some more obvious than others. We go back to Black Celebration or Construction Time Again, which was out in 1983, was a very kind of social album, to be quite honest.
Sort of proletariat imagery in some of the
You know, we grew up like on these council estates, like, you know, sort of, you know, poorer part of town, East London, east of London. And when you're told enough times that you're going to amount to nothing, you know, you react, you know, and that's what we did. We found a way. We found a way by making music and getting out of that place where we were to go kind of see the world for ourselves. Yeah. I've been lucky enough to do that. The title of the album is Spirit, and that came from really this idea that it's within all our spirits. You know, we all have a spirit, we all have something going on inside us, we all have a consciousness, and we can, at any time we want to, we can stop and choose to really feel what's going on there. And we all know when there's something's not right.
Yeah.
Everybody does. Yeah. I don't believe you don't. And me included, we take some really weird actions sometimes that lead us down the wrong garden path, right?
Yeah.
I'm no angel, that's for sure.
I did want to give you an opportunity. With Richard Spencer the other day tweeted out about Depeche Mode being the band of the alt-right. My first reaction was like, is this a joke? Because here's a guy who doesn't get it, right?
That's exactly how we reacted to be honest, that like it was some joke, like Tosh.0 or something was going to come up in a minute and just, you know, it was a joke.
Yeah.
Someone had put it together, but
the fact that you even had to put out a statement for something like that.
Well, we had to because, look, there's a lot of kooks out there, and everybody can have their opinion about something. You know, that's why we live here, and we're lucky to have that freedom. Let's hope that remains, right? To the freedom of speech and doing this kind of stuff. We don't want to get shut down, so it's more important now than ever. But some people just go way too out there, I think. And we didn't feel like he had any right to bring us into his shit. I mean, it was weird that we kind of felt it was weird that he would choose a band like us because we're so weird.
Well, also, it's like, have you heard any of your records before, right? Like,
I don't think he's really listened to anything, but I don't know. Maybe he was misreading some of the imagery.
Yeah.
But, you know, guys like Richard Spencer, he's a dangerous guy because he's really educated. And it surprises me someone that's so educated and so privileged could just be so bigoted and racist. You've been kept down.
You've been pushed around. want to talk about the video for Where's the Revolution and working with Anton Corbijn again.
Right.
It's a 30-year collaboration.
Yeah, which is wild as well, actually. Yeah.
What is it about him that you feel safe with?
That's a good word. He is he's a great artist, first of all, and a fantastic photographer. He understood our music. And yeah, he understood that it needed a visual, and that visual wasn't necessarily us.
Right.
It was his photography, it was his imagery, it was landscapes, it was, I mean, a video like Enjoy the Silence, it's just beautiful photography. And it was unique, and it still stands up today, but the concepts that he comes up with quite often, we're like baffled, we're like, really? You want me to dress up as a king and walk around with a deck chair? But we've learned to trust Anton. And same goes for Where's the Revolution. He had this idea. He wanted to have some sort of Marxist kind of imagery going on, which we were a bit dubious about. But he also had this idea of like, look, you're a rock and roll band that people look up to. You're kind of put on this pedestal. It's not that different. Mm-hmm. So we're going to put you on there as Dave Gahan from Depeche Mode. You're going to be on that sort of Marxist stand, and then we're going to have this imagery of you all dressed up as Karl Marx or something. Yeah. So the thing is very tongue-in-cheek.
At some point in time, there's going to be a retrospective of the work Anton has done specifically with you guys, both photography and in film.
Yeah, there's a few things actually in the works at the moment, but over the years, he has put out a couple of books which were just kind of like stuff with us, but he's got a book out called 1, 2, 3, and it's a book of photography, and there was a shot that he asked if he could put in there of me that was pretty revealing, early 90s, that he had taken of me in some hotel room when I was passed out. And at first I saw it, I was kind of horrified. But he said, can I use it? And I said, yeah, okay, that's what it was then. So he blew it up, and it was on this in this gallery in Hamburg. But I'm sure he's got many shots like that. I mean, Anton, we were friends for years as well when I lived in London. And when I was going through some pretty rough times, Anton was always kind of the guy that showed up. And he would just show up on my doorstep and kind of hang out with me and show me photographs and stuff, trying to keep me entertained. So yeah, he's our buddy, and he's kind of like, we used to call him like the fifth member, you know, of the band.
Just a side question based on that story is, you don't seem particularly shy about acknowledging, like when you see a photograph like that from a particular era that's behind you,
I don't.
How does that make you feel when you see that?
Well, you know, it's part of like what you go through in life. Everybody goes through their stuff, and you know, there's nothing new about rock and roll star going through his stuff, whatever, drink, alcohol, drugs, you know, whatever, a few wives, you know, that's changed for me in the last 20 years. But and there was a point in my life where I wasn't sure if I was going to sort of reach 35, you know, so it's kind of weird now when I think about that. You know, at that time I was ready. I was sort of like, well, if I'm going to go out, I'm going to go out with a bang. So I was hell-bent on having a good time, and that's where it got me. But I think it's important, you know, as well, like, to show that stuff or to be honest about who you are and what you were and what you've been through, and if you're lucky enough to come out on the other side, because maybe there's someone out there who's struggling with something and they don't think they can get to the other side, but you can, you know?
Sure.
And there's more life to be had.
It almost acts as a marker for how far you've come in a weird way, right?
When you've got, you know, there's these stages, there's definitely these pivotal moments, like in the life of Depeche Mode as well, if you like, that, you know, where we've all been through stuff, and you just, that's life, that goes on, but somehow the music has always managed to pull us together.
How has the recording, writing process between you and Martin evolved over the years, or has it remained consistent?
Well, I've kind of like nudged my way in there over the last like 20 years or something, 15, 20 years. And you know, for me still, Martin, when it comes to Depeche Mode, it's like that's Martin's role. He's written pretty much all the songs over the years that you guys all know. I'm kind of on the bench, and I get to play like now and again, and I do some special things now and again. I might get a three-pointer, but then, you know, I'm back on the bench, you know, and that's all right. That's okay with me. I got this guy that I'm in a band with who's written these great songs, so the standard is set really high. When I first heard the songs from this album, the demos that Martin had written, I was like, oh, well, there's a bunch of mine that's definitely got to go, because he'd written some songs that I wanted to sing. You've been fed truth. I'm really lucky. I know how blessed I am. Some days I don't even know why I'm still here. But when we start making music, I sort of remember. Like, it's not always about me. It's somehow, like, you make music and you suddenly see all these other people that it's really important to them. So that's that community, comes back to that community thing again. I believe in that. I believe in the power of people together. I really do. Where's the revolution?